Hello, everyone. Thank you again for joining us. I'm Pastor Kiyomo Butler with Restoration Victory Ministries. And, you know, for those of you all who were with us last week, and I kind of want to jump right back into where I left off because, you know, I want us to really get an understanding of where and who we need to be as children of God and where our faith should lie and how we should live our lives glorifying Jesus Christ and glorifying God the Father. You know, I was speaking last week about I was getting into telling a testimony, and so just for the sake of understanding, we know in the book of Revelation it says that the saints overcame by the blood of the Jesus, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. So I'm going to get right back into this testimony so we can understand. Now, you know, just for those of you all who may have joined us late on last week, remember, we have foundation scriptures that we're using for this ministry, and I'm going to give you the foundation scriptures. You can write them down and go back later on and study them yourself because I'm going to use them throughout today, but I just want to give them to you so you can have them. Romans 1:16, which talks about the gospel of Jesus Christ. Romans 10:17, which talks about our faith comes by hearing the word of God. And 2 Corinthians 1:20, which says that everything that God has given to us in his word is yes and amen to the glory of God the Father through us, through our actions, through us doing the works, through us believing. And also Matthew 9:29, which I added last week, which says that the Bible says, according to your faith, be it unto you. And that's very important, not according to my faith, because my faith can't save you. My desire to please God can't save you. My desire to live for God can't save you. My desire to glorify God in everything that I do can't do anything for you. It's according to your faith, your love, your belief, that is going to be the blessing for you and your life. And just real quickly, I said last week, and I said, you know, I can speak this prophetically, that there's coming a time where there's going to be a separation between the sheep and the goat. Those who believe and love Jesus Christ and who accept this word and understand the power of God. Because see, listen, praise God. Before I even go back into my testimony, I want to, you know, in the book of Romans, the 10th chapter, the 15th verse, the Bible says that how beautiful are the feet of him that preached the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. And, you know, what a lot of us don't really know, you know, if you don't really read and study the Old Testament, you don't know that a lot of things that they say in the New Testament, they are paraphrasing things that are said by the prophets in the Old Testament. And this particular passage of scripture, this particular word of scripture here is a scripture passage that was paraphrased by Paul speaking of what Isaiah had said in the word in the 52nd chapter of Isaiah. And I want to just read you the original what Isaiah said. And I say this a lot of times in the New Testament, if they don't write the whole scripture, sometimes in paraphrasing it, you really miss the shock and awe part of it, or you really miss the meat of it. Because how beautiful the feet of him that preached the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. That is beautiful, and I love that. But now I want to read you the original so you can really see, because that is my calling from God. You know, what I'm about to read to you, that is what the whole ministry, Restoration Victory, is about. It's about helping us to understand what Christ has done, what God has done, and then who we are through Christ Jesus. Isaiah 52:7, it says, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publishes peace, that bringeth good tidings of good, that publishes salvation, and that said unto Zion, your God reigneth. Now, once again, we see Romans 10:15 says, how beautiful are the feet of him that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But we see here in Isaiah how it says, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publishes peace, that brings good tidings of good, that publishes salvation, and that says unto Zion, your God reigns. Zion being the church. And in Isaiah, he's speaking of the children of Israel, the Holy Land, and the people of God. But for us as Christians, now this belongs to us. How beautiful are the feet of him that publishes peace and that says unto you, your God reigns. You remember, not last week, but the week before, I started a teaching, and this is kind of the conclusion of it that says, have faith in God, have faith in Jesus, and believe in yourself. See, the foundation of having faith in God and having faith in Jesus and believing in yourself is truly understanding that God reigns. The devil does not reign, nothing. The devil has no power, no control, and no authority over you as a born-again believer in Jesus Christ. But as with everything in this word, your victory, your restoration comes solely by you accepting it by your faith. The just shall live by their faith. Remember, the Bible says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. And the Bible also says that according to your faith, be it unto you. You know, the Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight. The just shall live by faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the word of God. And according to your faith, be it unto you. We have to get that in our minds. Now, last week I started telling you about, and I wanted to give you one or two quick testimonies just about my life and about where I was and how I know beyond a shadow of a doubt of the power of God and that God reigneth. That God reigned. Listen, Jesus' name, and I'm not going to get, because this is a history teaching, and I don't want to get too caught up in the history teaching, but we all understand that Jesus was a Jew. He was a Hebrew. He was an Israelite. He wasn't English, so he didn't speak the English language. So when Jesus walked this earth, his name wasn't Jesus. It was Yahushua. Now, the thing about that country and that culture is names meant things. When they gave people names, it meant something. When God sent the angel Gabriel to talk to Mary and told Mary, hey, his name shall be Yahushua, that actually means salvation. So, and I'm getting into this because I want you to understand where I'm going with this. Listen, when Isaiah, who was a Hebrew, who was an Israelite, spoke of how beautiful the feet of him that publishes salvation, that said unto Zion, your God reigneth. Isaiah was speaking with an understanding, a Hebrew understanding of salvation and what salvation meant and the salvation that Jesus was to bring to the children of God. So after I give you this testimony, I'm going to give you just a breakdown of salvation so you can truly understand what God has done for us and who God is. Because, beloved, if we start getting to the point where we truly understand that God is our Father, he is truly our Father. He is our Father just like you have an earthly father and plus some, you know. And I only say like you have an earthly father because for most of us, if we haven't gotten to a certain level of relationship with God, we can understand our relationship we should have with our earthly father. God is your daddy. He is your daddy. He is your heavenly father. And your father reigns. Your father has all power, all control, all authority in heaven and in earth. The Bible says that the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow, those in heaven, those on earth, and those below the earth. And every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord to the glory of God the Father. The Bible says that the same power that God used when he raised Jesus from the dead, and this is going to the prayer in Ephesians 1, and we started talking about this last week. He said that same power we have in us. He said, you know, the Bible, actually the prayer starts off saying, so I can give you the whole prayer so you can understand. It says that we'll be blessed with the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of God, that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened, that we will know God's calling for our lives as children of God, that we will understand the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. We will understand the exceeding greatness of his power towards us who believe. Boy, that's great. The exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe. Understanding the riches of his inheritance in the saints. And the greatness of his power toward us who believe. According to the working of his mighty power. Listen to this. According to the working of his mighty power. So the same power that we have in us to help us to be blessed with wisdom, to understand the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, to understand the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, the same power that he used when he raised Christ Jesus from the dead. So what the Bible is saying is that the same power that was used by God to raise Jesus from the dead, which is, listen, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that power is awesome. We know that power is awesome. We know that power is unbelievable. We know that power can't be understood with the natural mind. We know that that power is supernatural and it is the power of God. Well, that same power is the power that's available to us to have wisdom, to understand and to know, to be blessed to know our riches, to be blessed to know our inheritance as saints of God, as children of God, to understand the hope and the calling that God has upon our life, to understand all we need to know about God. That same power that God has used when he raised Christ from the dead, the power of God, the spiritual power of God, is available to us. But once again, we have to believe that God reigneth. Now, why do I say that? I say that because, listen, going back to my testimony from last week, beloved, I'm going to give you the testimony. You know, Paul had a road to Damascus experience in which he was not a child of God. He wasn't looking to be a Christian. He wasn't praying. He wasn't fasting. He wasn't calling to God to help him to understand. He was actually on his way to destroy Christians, kill more Christians. He had already killed some. So I'm trying to say that the power of God, the most holy and the most awesome power of God, can penetrate anything and anyone at any time. You don't have to be in a holy assembly. God can get you, if God has a calling and anointing on you, and God has spoken something to you or spoken something on your life, God can come and get you at any point and any time. But just like Paul, when God came and grabbed him, and then when Ananias, and he went and he healed Paul, he took the scales off Paul's eyes, Paul had right there at that point to make a decision to believe, to accept the power of God, and to move in the power of God. Because it could have been easy for Paul at that point to say, man, this is not God. Man, this is the devil. Man, this is some demon. Man, this is some demon trying to stop me from doing what I was doing before. Paul accepted, and he understood the power of God, and he was able to move in that power. And I know this is not a traditional teaching, but this is what we need to understand, the power of God. Listen, beloved, I can remember vividly, I was at a point in my life where I had made a bunch of mistakes and I was blaming everybody else. And it's amazing, and I'm speaking to somebody right now, it's amazing how we, in our sinful state, get mad at God. You know, I was a sinner. I was living and I was partying and I was clubbing and I was drinking and I was whoremongering and I was doing everything wrong. I was doing everything but saying my prayers. And I had decided that because the world wasn't treating me the way I wanted it to treat me. Now, once again, I was a sinner, hanging with sinners, around sinners. I wasn't around Christians. I wasn't around people who loved and honored Jesus Christ. But yet, I was judging the gospel, or I was making a faith decision based upon what I thought to be true, living in the world. It's amazing how we do that. We'll be in the world, and we'll be getting the things of the world, but yet we're mad at God, and we want to go against God because we're in a sinful state, living in a sinful situation, doing sinful things, but yet we want to blame it on God because things aren't working out the way we wanted to. Whoever's listening to me and whoever that's for, listen, that can't be so. The only way that you can expect God, the Bible says that in the book of Ephesians, book of Galatians, the 6th chapter says, be not deceived, God is not mocked. Galatians 6th chapter. Be not deceived, God is not mocked. It says, whatsoever man shall sow it, that he shall also reap. If you sow it to your spirit, you shall of your spirit reap everlasting life. If you sow to your flesh, you shall of your flesh reap corruption. And it says, let no man deceive you with empty words. It says, because of these empty words come the wrath of God on the children of disobedience. What the Bible is saying is, listen, even for non-believers, whatever you put out there, whatever lifestyle you're in, whatever you're doing, whatever situation you're in, you're going to reap the benefits of that situation. So back for me, I'm sinning and I'm expecting godly results. I'm expecting people to act like children of God in a sinful situation. And I was a sinner. So I made the mistake of saying, I was like, hey, you know, I'm getting tired of this. I'm getting tired of that. I decided I was going to become a member of another faith. And I was like, you know, because they are righteous and they look out for each other. And I said that and I was angry. And I'm trying to give you the contrast so you can understand the power of God. Because right now I just want you to understand the power of God. I was angry. I was cursing. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. And I was mad. And all of a sudden, just like this, instantly, I went from angry to I felt like somebody had grabbed my heart and twisted it, and I start crying like a baby. I went from angry and mad to crying like a baby and apologizing to Jesus Christ. Oh, I'm so sorry. I was sorry, God. You didn't make me to be like this. I don't know what I'm saying. Forgive me for being so foolish to open my mouth to say something like that. And I apologized to God and cried for so long that I started laughing at myself because I couldn't stop crying. So I went from angry and cursing to crying like a baby to laughing. But beloved, that was the most exhilarating and freeing moment of my life. So I know, I'm not telling you what nobody else said. I know the power of God. And when I got to the point where, when I finished laughing and I gathered myself From that point on, I made a decision to live my life for Jesus Christ. Now, see, the greatest thing about the power of God, and I said this, and I said all this to say that there are many watching now who say, well, man, I can't change. Man, listen, it's not that you can't. It's that you've decided that you don't want to. Because the Holy Spirit of God, the power of God, can change and touch anybody. I'm giving you a real life experience. And I talked about Paul of Tarsus. And those are just two examples. There are many examples in this word, and there are many other testimonies from many other men and women of God where God has touched their life, and then they made a decision at that point to live for God. See, the point is that when God touches you, you have to humble yourself unto God. The Bible says in Romans 12, 1 and 2, it says, I beseech you by the mercies of God that you present your body as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. You be not conformed to the world, and you be transformed by renewing your mind. So you have to renew your mind. You have to accept according to your faith be it unto you. You have to make that decision. But beloved, God is God. God can do what he wants, when he wants, how he wants. You know, there are some of us out there right now, and I said this last week, and I wanted to kind of segue into this right now. Listen, beloved, don't let no one steal, praise God, your calling and your anointing from you. If God has called you to do something, if God has spoken something on your life, if God has put something in your spirit and in your heart, do not let no one tell you that God doesn't work that way anymore. Don't let no one steal your faith from you because they don't have faith. Don't let anyone steal your calling from you because your calling is not their calling, because they don't understand, because they don't accept, because they have too much head knowledge to accept the things of the Spirit of God. Listen, if it's in this word, and I'm saying that because I'm speaking about healing, I'm speaking about casting out of demons. I'm speaking about dreams and visions. I'm speaking about God speaking to people in audible voices. If it's of the power of the Holy Spirit of God, then beloved, you believe it. Because only thing that matters is you know that you have to know, praise God, that your spirit is right. The Bible says that the purpose of the whole commandment is love out of a pure heart, out of a sincere faith, and out of a good conscience. If you know that your heart is pure, and you know that you have made a decision to follow Christ, then you let Christ lead you into his glory. Because I say this again, time is coming where those who accept and believe and love Jesus Christ, the sheep, shall do great things. They shall be restored in victory. And they shall live a life of victory because they are restored in Christ Jesus. Because they actually believe that this word of God is true. You know, the reason why I brought up this scripture from Isaiah 52, when it says, how beautiful upon the mountains are the feet of him that bringeth good tidings, that publish peace, that bringeth good tidings of good, that publisheth salvation, and that said unto Zion, your God reigneth, is because that is what I'm here to do. Restoration, victory. We have to be restored in Christ Jesus unto victory. You know, for so long we've looked at salvation one way, just saved, going to heaven. But salvation in the Hebrew, which the root word of it is Yasha and Yahshua, which was the Hebrew name of Jesus, it has a lot of different definitions. Salvation means peace. Salvation means prosperity. It means being made whole, being made sound, being preserved, being safe, being covered, being delivered. Salvation gives the understanding and the idea that you have been set free, you have been delivered, you have been redeemed. You know, the greatest thing about salvation is it covers. You know, a while back we looked at this, and I'll say it again just for the sake of understanding. In Acts 10 and 38, when Peter was talking, Peter said, you know the word that the Lord sent unto the children of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, for he is the Lord of all. And that comes from the King James Version. And if you look in the Amplified, that same scripture in the Amplified Version, what the Bible says, that you know the word that the Lord sent unto the children of Israel, preaching the good news, preaching the gospel unto the children of Israel by Jesus Christ. He is the Lord of all. So we know that the good news that we preach and that we hear, and the gospel of Jesus Christ that we preach and we hear, is the gospel of peace. And you know, and I've covered peace, the word peace, the Hebrew meaning of the word peace is shalom. And shalom gives the idea of understanding that you have nothing missing and nothing broken in your life. You're not sick, you're not broke, you're not broken down, you're not depressed, you're not angry, you're not having mental issues, you're not going through any. It means, it gives the understanding that everything in your life is complete. Nothing missing, nothing broken, all is good, all is well. Complete inner peace and complete outer peace. Listen, Jesus said in John 10 and 10, and this one statement could really solidify what salvation means. Jesus said that the thief, the enemy, he's talking about Satan, comes but to steal, kill, and destroy. I came that you should have life and life more abundantly. Now, the life Jesus was talking about was the Zoe life, the God kind of life. As Christians, we can only have that life through the Holy Spirit of God dwelling within us, giving us the Spirit of God so we can live that Zoe kind of life. Salvation, according to what Isaiah meant, being complete, being whole, being redeemed. When you're redeemed, you know, we understand the word redeem, and I'm going through words that are Christian words that we use so we can get an understanding of what God has done, because your God reigneth. Now, we got to remember that your God reigns. And we have to remember that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee shall bow. I think it's important for us right now to get this understanding. Have faith in God. Your God reigns. Listen, your God reigns. You know, right here, it also says, and I want to just read this so you can see it. You know, it gives a bunch of different names of God. And they call him, you know, the Holy One of Israel, the Most High God, the Lord of the heaven and earth. The Bible says that the earth is God's footstool. The Bible says that the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof. So, you know, we understand that God reigns. Your God, the children of Zion, the children of God, Christians, followers of Jesus Christ, your God, your Father reigns. And then at the name of Jesus Christ, through the blood of Jesus that we have shed upon us, every knee must bow and every tongue must confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord to the glory of God the Father. Listen, the Bible says that when Jesus ascended up on high, he held captivity captive, which means captivity, Satan. He held them captive. The Bible also says that when Jesus ascended up on high, he defeated them, making an open spectacle of them. Now, praise God. We got to understand this. This may be a little deep, but bear with me. You know, we always look in Romans 10, and the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and if you believe in your heart that God is raising from the dead, you shall be saved. It says, from with the heart, with our spirit, man, we believe unto righteousness. With the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Now, I want to ask you a question. Do you think that this means that you have to go to the front of the church? This confession, where do you think this confession comes from? Beloved, listen, I'm going to say this to you, and I'm going to say this to you in all honesty. That confession is more of a spiritual confession than it is a physical confession. Now, as children of God, we have to fellowship with other children of God. We can't forsake the gathering of ourselves together with the saints. So I'm not saying that. I'm not saying don't join a church. I'm not saying don't have a church home. I'm not saying don't fellowship with brothers and sisters. I'm not saying don't follow the man of God that God has anointed to lead you, because that is not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is that before you were born again, all right, Colossians 1:13, it says that we give thanks unto God the Father who has made us able to be a partaker of the inheritance of light. He has delivered us from the power of darkness over here, translated us into the kingdom of Christ Jesus. We have redemption through the blood of Jesus. We have the forgiveness of our sins through the blood of Jesus. Before you were born again, you were a sinner. You belong to Satan. And in the spirit world, Satan had authority and control over you. When you confess, your confession is to the spirit world. Hey, God, I choose you. Jesus, I choose you. Satan, you have no more power over me. So then at that point, you're delivered from the power of Satan and you're translated into Jesus' kingdom. It's a spiritual thing. See, it's a spiritual anointing and it's a spiritual victory. And the greatest thing about that is when you're translated into this kingdom of Christ Jesus, Satan, you know, I'm going to say this like my grandmother used to say to me, Satan will be a fool to try to mess with you when you're God's. And for the man or woman that lives by his faith and that understand that his God reigns, that understand that he no more has to be messing with Satan or bothered by Satan because he has been delivered. Listen, the word redemption means to be, it gives the idea of someone paying a bond for you. Jesus, the Bible says in one of the scriptures that we use a lot in this ministry, 1 Corinthians 6:19-20, when it's talking about your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit, for the Spirit of God is in you, which you have from God, saying you are not your own, for you were bought with a price. And I like to say blood bought with a price. You were redeemed. Jesus paid the price. He paid his blood, paid the price for you and your sin. So when Jesus went over there and shed his blood over you, you were no more Satan's. Now you belong to Jesus. You belong to the kingdom of light. You belong to God. Satan has no more authority over you. So you have to understand that. And then that goes to see, we know God reigns. We know Jesus and the power and the, you know, and the problem that we have as Christians, and we, you know, I got about 8 minutes left and I'm going to really drive this home now. And I hope after I finish that everybody will get up, not with an S on their chest, but they'll have a big C on their chest. Head up, shoulders up, sticking to the back, as we, as young men are taught, walk with your head up and your shoulders back, with that big C on our chest. Christians, Christ, because you will understand that blood has been shed for you. Listen, we know, and a lot of times we accept God reigns, but we don't really accept